Hello! I bought something on AliExpress again. The other day, I introduced products I bought on AliExpress that are useful for electronic work. This is the sequel of that video. Please watch the last video if you like. This time, some of the things I bought are products that would never be on Japanese shopping websites. I'm going to review them here. I attached the links of the things I bought in the description and comment sections. If you find something you like, purchase them from the links. Now let's look at the first items. The first items are actual semiconductor wafers. What is more, circuit patterns are already formed on them. They seem suitable for educational purposes. Listen to the sound. It's the sound of a real wafer. You can never obtain these things in the Japanese market because of regulations. I wasn't sure if I can get real silicone wafers from AliExpress, so I bought four of them just in case. I bought two largest wafers of 12-inch diameter and two smaller wafers of 8-inch diameter. You can choose from 6, 8, and 12 inches. I was very worried that the wafers may be damaged during shipping, but as you can see, they arrived safely. I cannot show you the shipping packages right now because I got rid of them, but these wafers came in specialized packages, which was reassuring. I would have been in shock if they had been shattered in pieces. To be honest, I'm not sure where these silicone wafers with circuit patterns came from. It's possible that products of a faulty lot are directly sold by the semiconductor fab. Either way, it's a mystery. In China, it's already common for a factory to manufacture semiconductor chips from 12-inch wafers. Let's have a closer look at the circuits on the silicone wafers. This one is the 12-inch wafer. This one's got various chips formed on it. Various chips are all mixed together, including memory chips and logic chips. Next, we're looking at the other 12-inch wafer, the bluish one. This one's got only one type of chips formed on it. Zoomed in. Wonder what this gold part does. It's shaped like a crab. I guess it works as a circuit just like the other parts. If anyone knows, please leave a comment. The actual semiconductor circuits are formed on these wafers, but you cannot cut them out and use them on devices. They are purely for decoration. By the way, I wasn't sure what kind of wafers would arrive, but the ones I got were the same as the photos on the website. As for this blue wafer, I think it's coated with a film. It looks blue because the color of the film is blue. The other day, I uploaded a video of when I visited a Toshiba Power Semiconductor fab. At the fab, I saw a wafer of power semiconductors. Power semiconductor wafers look very different from these wafers for logic and memory chips. If you want to see how they manufacture power semiconductors in the fab, watch the video from the link in the description. When I bought these wafers, I also bought these special cases for wafers. I bought them on a Japanese shopping website. This is a professional case that's actually used for industrial purposes. It's quite expensive. Costs $94. When you want to store a wafer, if you put it in this case, it's unlikely to break. The case is pretty much sturdy. You can also put it on a photo stand. Here. It looks cool. I like it. It can be used as an education material, but I think it's also nice to use it as an interior decoration. I want to put it on the shoe rack at the entrance. The most expensive one is $37.50, which is not too much. Considering these wafers are industrial waste, this is quite a wily deal. As written in the description of this product, it would be nice to give this to your loved one as a birthday gift. I highly recommend these wafers. Next is this one, a reflow plate powered by USB PD. This is a fairly small reflow plate. I bought it for about $12. There's a charging socket and control buttons at the back. Let's turn it on. The lowest temperature setting is 0 degrees Celsius. This plate may be assumed to be used in a freezing environment. The maximum temperature setting is 350 degrees Celsius. For example, you can reflow a small board like this. It can also be used to preheat only a part of a large board. You can also use it to preheat a component with a large heat capacity like this one. Let's turn it on. It's heating. The temperature is rising. It's rising quickly. Just in case, I'll check if the solder melts nicely. The solder I'm using is lead-free solder wire. This is the label. It melted. When the displayed temperature reached around 200 degrees Celsius, the solder melted. I think you can use this without problems. However, once the displayed temperature exceeds 200 degrees Celsius, the temperature starts to rise very slowly. So, even if you set the temperature to 350 degrees Celsius, it's not likely that the actual temperature reaches 350 degrees Celsius. The solder's melted completely. I measured the actual temperature of the plate. The actual temperature is 14 degrees higher than the displayed temperature. If you are watching this video and considering purchasing this reflow plate, I recommend to perform calibration. I also measured the highest temperature. I set the plate to 350 degrees Celsius, and the highest was about 270 degrees Celsius or higher. A lot of heat escapes from the plate itself. So I don't think the temperature rises any further. This is a pretty good product. But there are some flaws. Firstly, the control buttons are on the backside of the device. When you try to push them, you get burnt if you grab the device wrong. The plate gets pretty hot. The device is not stable, so I put rubber pad stickers on the backside. It helped a lot. Now it's a lot more stable. This device is pretty light, so even after putting on the rubbers, it easily tumbles over just by being pulled by the cable. You cannot say it became completely stable. There's another flaw. The surface of the Reflow plate is a little bit uneven. You cannot press a circuit board against the plate completely. Although Ito has some drawbacks, this product works just fine for casual purposes, so I'm very happy with this. Next, this is also a Reflow plate, but this one is a little bigger and looks more solid. It's made by a manufacturer called Mechanic. I purchased this Reflow plate for just under $19. Including shipping fee, it's nearly $25. Unlike the PD-powered Reflow plate we saw earlier, this one draws power from the outlet. According to the PSE law, Reflow plates are classified as the specified electrical appliances and materials, but I couldn't find the PSE mark. It's because this product wasn't manufactured for Japan. This is an overseas product, so you can choose from two power supply voltages, 110 and 200 volts. Be careful not to buy the product of the wrong voltage. Compared to the Reflow plate we saw earlier, this one is about 1.5 times larger. As it's larger, it's more stable. The minimum temperature setting is 40 degrees Celsius and the maximum is 260 degrees Celsius. I turned it on, but the temperature is rising a lot slower than the smaller Reflow plate. It may be because the heat capacity of this plate is larger. For a device powered with 100 volt AC, the output power is a bit poor. As I did earlier, I put a lead-free solder on the plate. Let's see if it melts. It started melting. It's melting. The plate is working fine, as you can see. The solders melt nicely. The actual temperature of the plate is about 30 degrees lower than the specified temperature. There's a large difference between the display temperatures. Some lead-free solder may not melt on this plate, compared to the Reflow plate we saw earlier. This one has a thicker plate and its surface is more even. This plate seems to be able to conduct heat more efficiently. The only drawback is that the maximum temperature is a bit low. By the way, it comes with these clips to hold the circuit board, but they often get in the way, so it's probably better to remove them. I used to use this hot plate to do Reflow soldering. It was troublesome to put this thing away. If you use this small Reflow plate, it takes a lot less time and energy to do Reflow soldering. This small Reflow plate is perfect for someone who wants to make a circuit using surface mount devices and a small board. The price is only $12 to $25. There's no harm in buying one. Next is this device, a kind of tester. It's manufactured by Mechanic. I purchased it for $54. To be honest, it was not a good idea to buy this device. It's too expensive for a device that can measure only a few items. Two probes are attached to the aluminum device. Each probe has an LCD screen to show the value. The same value is also displayed on the device. On the other side of the device, two alligator clips are connected. You can measure the same items as the probes with these clips. The appearance is sophisticated. Let's see what you can measure with this. You can measure DC voltages in this way. The voltage is shown on the screens on the probes. The same value is displayed on the main device. This tester can measure only DC voltages. Moreover, it can only measure voltages under 25 volts. If the voltage exceeds 25 volts, the displayed value stops at 24.198. You can switch the measurement modes by pressing the button on the device. If you long press this button, you can switch between right-handed mode and left-handed mode. The second thing you can do is to detect short or open circuits. When the circuit is open, the screen says open. When the circuit is shorted, it plays a beeping sound. That's all. The third is to measure the forward voltage drop across the diode. The value is displayed here. With this device, you can measure the voltage, detect open and short circuit, and measure the forward voltage drop across the diode. There are only three things you can do. It was a disappointment. The contact of this probe was poor, so I tried disassembling it. The tip of the probe is screwed in. The screw part was corroded. It's rusty. I bought this product on the official website of Mechanic, and yet it arrived in this state. It may have been stored in a humid place for a long period of time. In the voltage measurement mode, both probes display the same value. It's a bit of a waste, isn't it? For example, you could use the alligator clip to get the reference potential and display the positive and negative potentials on each of the probes. It's a bit of a waste to implement many displays for only one purpose. I like that you can check the voltage on the probe. It's very useful, but it's not worth the price. Compared to the super cheap $19 digital multimeter that I introduced in another video, this product is of little use. If you have any ideas for the use of this meter, please leave a comment. And finally, this product. This is a device that vaporizes rosin. I bought it for about $9. What this device does is to vaporize rosin and apply the rosin onto a circuit, which allows you to detect the part of the circuit that's heating up. I often see it in Chinese repairing videos. Let's apply rosin onto this board. When you press the button, the rosin melts and atomizes inside and comes out like this. A lot of rosin came out. This is the tip of the device. This is where you put the rosin. Let's put the rosin in here and press the button. Then it starts to heat up and melt the rosin. Then you can apply the vaporized rosin onto the board. Let's try it out. Suppose there is a fault in the circuit. Let's say the faulty part of the board is abnormally heating up. Apply the rosin like this. The smoke is coming out. Let's say this part of the circuit is broken and it generates a lot of heat when you turn on the power. Check this out. The rosin melts at the heating spots. This allows you to identify the faulty spots. Let's do it again. Apply the rosin on the board. Then turn on the power. The faulty spots heat up abnormally and only the rosin on the spots melts. You can identify heating spots using rosin in this way, but as you can see, it's a lot easier to use a thermal camera. Thermal cameras are more expensive, but you can tell the heating spots way easier using them. Also, using this device is harder than I thought. The rosin gets blown away by the wind. If there is even a little wind, the rosin doesn't fall exactly where I want it. Also, you need to clean the rosin off the board afterwards. It gets sticky. I bought this product out of curiosity, but I don't think I'm going to use it. Thermal cameras are a lot better. So I introduced the products I bought on AliExpress. You will never know whether the things you bought on an international shopping website are good or not until you actually receive them. This time, this wafer and these reflow plates were good. But I'm not very happy with this Rosin atomizer and this tester. I didn't need to buy them. Recently, when I buy things on AliExpress, they often arrive about a week after purchase. It used to take a month or so, but recently AliExpress became a lot more convenient. When I get the chance, I want to introduce the things I bought on AliExpress from time to time. If you find this video useful, please comment, like, and subscribe to the channel. Thank you for watching.